All right, so we're gonna have three different talks by people from TACC and NERSC and ALCF to talk about the current state of their K&L system. So things are early, so collect your questions and we'll do some time for questions and a bit of a panel at the end.
Right, hello, I'm from ALCF. I'm Kalyan Kumaran, I go by Kumar, people know me by Kumar. I'm supposed to be the Deputy Director of Science, whatever that means. Yeah. I manage the data science, the performance engineering, and the data analysis groups, or at least I oversee that. The other thing I do is, for non-Oregon folks, we have something called JLSE, which stands for a joint laboratory for system evaluation, and all non-production systems that are in ALCF or used in MCS research are actually hosted by JLSE. And so our early K&L cluster that we got, even before we got access to Theta system or for any CRAE resources, is all hosted in JLSE. We still have 11 node K&L cluster that the ESP projects or the ESP science projects at ALCF and other software developers in computer science research actually use. And that has been more used than the Theta system. A disclaimer, the Theta system is currently going through acceptance. And so I was told that I cannot present any performance results because the system has not been accepted. And any results out of acceptance, I can't discuss them right here. So much of my talk will be on configuration and timeline and how we plan to use it. So I might come across as more of a marketing person than a technical person. So I apologize for that, but do ask me questions. If there are things that I can answer or answer in a way that things don't get recorded, I'll definitely do that. So I won't repeat what Mike Papka actually talked about half an hour ago. Our production resource now is the Mira BlueGene Q system, which has a proprietary processor, the PowerPC, and it's currently being used for our Insight and ALCC and our discretionary science programs, allocation programs. Theta comes in between Mira and our next production resource that's supposed to be coming in around 2018, which is Aurora, which the Knights Hill processor. And so what does Theta provide us from an application and an operational point of view? Theta gives us access to many core architecture, the Xeon Phi, the second generation version of it, for applications to get familiar with that and the programming environment. We are not used to the Cray programming environment or the Intel compilers since we have always used the IBM. For the past 8 years or so. So that is a learning experience for us before Aurora comes in. And also, we currently run the GPFS file system. And if we choose to move on to the Lustre file system for Aurora, Theta provides us an understanding of the Lustre file system from an operational management point of view. So this is Theta by the numbers. What we are getting is an 8.62 petaflop machine. It's got 18 compute racks and 3,240 compute nodes, or each compute node is a single K&L socket. There are three SKUs, that's the Intel terminology, that Intel has currently made available for K&L. The top SKU is the 7250, which is, they used to call it bin one, they're Intel, but they hate that name now. Now they have a marketing term of better, best, great, good, or something like that. Those are the four SKUs. So the top SKU 7250 has 68 cores, runs, I think, at 1.4 gigahertz. The second SKU, which is the one we are getting, is the 7230, which runs at 1.3 gigahertz and has 64 cores. And there is another SKU, the lower one, which is 7210, which is basically 64 cores and 1.1 gigahertz. The memory, the maximum memory you can put on, it's DDR4 memory. You have six channels. We use 32 gig DIMMs and fully populate all the six channels. So we have 192 gigs per node. The maximum you can put is 384, so there are 64 gig DIMMs if you can afford the price. The bus speed is, they are DDR4 2400 DIMMs. I think the lowest queue, the top two SKUs, what they call as bin one, bin two, are the best and greatest, support the 2400, and the third one supports the 2100. If you go to their Intel website, you'll find out that they are planning to release a 72-core chip too. That should be available, they say, in October. And then they also, these are SKUs where the HFI, their OmniPath 1 network chip is not on chip. Those varieties, those flavors would also be available sometime in the near future, I think in the last quarter of this year. The IPM on chip is 16 gigs. And I don't know about the TAC system and the NERSC system. I'm going to listen to their presentation, just like you guys are going to. One thing we have is also a local SSD. We don't have a burst buffer for the Theta configuration. We do have a local SSD, which is 128 gigs in capacity, and it's on every node. So it gives you access to a local file system, where you can write intermediate results that you want to throw away, or you want to checkpoint and save and write it to the global file system later. What else? It's a Dragonfly topology, and there are 18 racks. Two of the racks form a single group in the Dragonfly topology, if you're familiar with it. So there are nine groups. We have Lustre router nodes, which are 30 in number. These write to the Lustre file system. There are 10 petabytes Lustre file system that is available. And through DBS, we also mount the GPFS file system. There are 60 of them, 60 nodes, and we mount the GPFS file system. So you have access to the Mira file system, which is GPFS, and so you can move files easily between Theta and Mira. Does everybody know what Theta stands for? It's not the Greek letter. Mira is supposed to be a star. I say supposed to be also because it's supposed to be a old German calculator too. So you can either, it can be the German calculator or it can be the star, but if you think it's the star, then we named Aurora as the Aurora Borealis, not the city next to Naperville. and so we have to find a name, so we found Theta. So it's one of those stars nobody knows about, but it's there. So Theta is just like that. So it's not getting a lot of fame because of Mira and Aurora, but it's there. That's my explanation, not ALCF. So, any questions on this? All right. So, if never seen this picture, this is the Cray XC40 system building blocks. The single compute node, as you would call it, is a single KNL socket. It says up to 72 cores because that was the original plan, and they plan to still support a 72-core chip that's soon to be released, they say October. So if you take a single KNL socket or chip or compute node and add four of them and an Aries Cray network chip, then you get a single compute blade. 16 of those blades go into a chassis, which is the next picture in that arrow, and three of those chassis goes into a single rack. And so there are 18 racks, 3,240 nodes connected together in a dragonfly topology, which makes up the Theta system. So there are additional racks. I don't know if there's a machine room trip arranged for you guys, but when you go to the machine room, you would see 11 blower cabinets. So the 18 are just the compute cabinets. So there is a blower cabinet that it starts with, and then there are two compute cabinets, and then there's a blower cabinet, two compute cabinets, there's a blower cabinet. So there are 11 blower cabinets. It's very loud. When you go into the middle, you can actually hear the noise outside. There is also a single cabinet for system management. Services go in there, and there are four cabinets where the Lustre file system goes in. Any questions on this slide? All right. So this is another schematic picture of the Theta system. This is what you see on the left is the single cabinet, which is the system management cabinet. Our Lustre file system is the Sonexion 3000, which is basically, I think, it's a Seagate product resold by Cray. There is a 648 port InfiniBand switch to which it is connected to. The LNET routers, people who are, here from Oregon, familiar with the MIRA terminology, this is the what is the equivalent to the I/O nodes on MIRA. So there are two types of processors here. The main compute processor is, of course, the Xeon Phi, second generation, or what you call as KNL, Knight's Landing, with the 7230 SKU. The other processor available is the Broadwell processors, which makes up the service nodes and other nodes. Some of them here are diskless nodes with about 64 gigs of memory, and some of them there have about 128 gigs of memory. Any questions on this? I mean, I don't know how much I should talk about it. It's not an architecture talk, but if I was prohibited from using any performance slides, maybe, and I have to talk for 20 minutes, do you have any questions? Yeah. Which line?
Number of connections.
Oh, that's the number of links, I think, or number of ports that it's connected to. Yeah. Okay. So the 210 gigabytes per second is the number that is in our statement of work, which and maybe it is capable of accomplishing much more than 210 gigabytes per second. The bandwidth to the GPFS file system is supposed to be 400 gigabytes per second. Any additional questions? I was supposed to repeat the question, I'm sorry. So wait for the microphone and then speak so that I don't, if I don't follow your question, I might just answer my own favorite question.
Yeah, please.
The LNET routers are to go from the FTR InfiniBand to the RES?
The LNET routers are the ones that connect the compute nodes to the Lustre file system. So they have, each one of them have two dual port FTRs that connect to the FTR switch to the Lustre file system.
On the other side, the RES?
On the compute nodes, yes.
So the LNET routers is to convert the FTR to the
RES.
Any problems with that?
I haven't seen. I mean, you should ask a Cray person, but we haven't seen anything so far. So
any increase in latency or?
We haven't done any. I mean, I cannot discuss any performance data, and so unfortunately, yeah. I know the answers to all your questions, but I cannot discuss it either. That's the. You can save some questions for the NERSC contact guys too. So.
My question about SSD, so each node on Tetra has SSD, one SSD card?
All the compute nodes have.
All
so
compute
the 3,240.
How's the user access SSD?
Uh-huh, that's a good question. So because you looked at my slides previously and asked this interesting question. So he's been set up by ALCF to ask this question, actually. Sorry. Cray doesn't provide any software for accessing the SSDs. In user application user space, you can use POSIX.io to access them.
Data warp?
You're asking if they work?
Data warp or API?
We don't, yeah, you could. That is what Cray would support it, but we haven't purchased data warp. We don't plan to support it. What we are doing is it's usable. People can write to it interim results if they want to through it. We will provide a piece of software either based on Romeo or, I mean, we are working with the MPI developers, or write our own that would collect all the data and write it back to the global file system if you want to save it between jobs. So that's what we are doing on. And we've kind of identified, you know, we are working with the early science applications, the six of them. Tim will talk about it. We are trying to identify places where they would make use of these SSDs we'll make sure that they whatever the goals that they have are accomplished through our software. So,
this moment, what's the main main workflow main pattern of using SSD? It's like for prefetching.
Don't have a
checkpointing.
We don't have a burst buffer. That's what I would point. Or if you have interim results. That you want to write to. So the SSDs are, in a way, I mean, they are not byte addressable, they're block addressable. We want to simulate the memory hierarchies that could be on our future systems. The speeds and feeds are very similar to what you would have, say, with non-volatile memory. So we want to be able to simulate that and have applications thinking about it more as memory as opposed to as disk, but what we have today is just disk, so. No. Ash that it's got wear-out specs too. It's basically a Samsung drive. No, it's not the most recent, no, yeah. We all would love to have it. No, it's not.
So what are your policies about the data that's on there? Does it get erased after each job, or what happens to it?
Those are things that need to be worked out. So those are beyond. That's, I mean, my job is performance. I mean, I lead a performance team. So it's basically coming up with ways to use it. I'm sure the science team will come up with policies as to who can use it, how you can use it, and all that. So
maybe more of a policy decision as well, but since SSDs are consumables, how are you going to prevent users from destroying the drives?
Right, correct. I think they are
there. don't use
think
them.
So they destroy the compute node. They are replaceable, I think. FRUs, field replaceable units, but I do not know what the policy is. And in the beginning, you know, we would like people to use it, right, so that we can write some stories of success on that. But if it does become too much, then yeah, definitely we have to create policies around that, yeah.
So we have a lot of SSDs in our data center, and most of them survive the 2-3 years we use them. So I wouldn't expect too many of them going down. I hope they're Intel hardware.
So the Intel, no, it's not the Intel SSDs. I think they have different specs than they. These are Samsungs. The Intel Adams Pass board, which is the Intel board that you get the KNL SD,
KNL nodes from Colfax. They have an SSD too, but that's the Intel SSDs, that thing. I don't know who makes them. Maybe Intel makes them, so.
Just a clarification. You said you're using the SSDs for the users. So the operating system is loaded during boot time completely into RAM and nothing else on the SSD?
Nothing on the SSD, no. Yeah. Any other questions? Oh, it's another Jack.
Let me just repeat that. So I think that brings up a good point that since we have the SSDs on each node, one possible use case would be to put the OS on the SSDs so that you can potentially drastically improve the boot times.
There are any ALCF operations people who have thought about it? You could answer that, but yeah.
Wait, we should probably let Kumar finish. These are probably good questions for the panel to ask across all the centers as well.
So this is the standard Cray marketing slide for their programming environment. Anything in blue is basically Cray software that they develop and support. Anything in red is third-party ISV software that is licensed, like the debuggers, third-party compilers like Intel and PGI. We plan to definitely purchase the Intel, not definitely. We do have the Intel compilers on the system. We haven't invested in PGI. People haven't shown a lot of interest in using the PGI compilers from my experience running the KNLs at the JLSC. Between TotalView and DDT, we have DDT supported on Mira, and we plan to have it supported, or we do have a license for it today on Theta. Anything in green is third-party packaging, third-party software that's non-licensed. And anything in white is basically third-party software that Cray packages and adds value to it. Maybe they make sure it works and support it. So the other thing is, since we are moving from Mira to the Cray environment, from the IBM programming environment to the Cray, for our users to make sure that they are used to the same tools, and the compilers are different, but they are used to the same tools that they made use on Mira or make use on Mira, what we have is a yearly performance project, for a lack of a good, better terminology. This is very similar to the early science project that Tim will talk about. And we basically did this on Mira, and it was widely successful that we continued this for Theta, and we plan to do that for Aurora too, which is to work with the community and make sure that all their software is available for the ESP projects to use. And this is basically providing them early access. This is basically getting their NDAs in place with Intel so that they get to know what is being supported. And if there are any questions that they would need in terms of microarchitecture and all that, those are answered. So much of the performance tools, debugger software, and libraries are currently available on Theta, and the early science program, once it kickstarts after the acceptance, can make use of this. And many of these tools is what folks are using on Mira, and so it would be an easy transition for our users to go from an IBM environment to a Cray / Intel environment. Yeah, sorry, go ahead.
Are you using a tickless kernel in your OS?
What is the diskless?
A tickless kernel. So a kernel, normally the Linux kernels are interrupted about 1,000 times per second.
No, this is the Cray software stack. I don't know. They use the diskless thing. I don't know if that there are any OS guys who can answer that. I can find the answer. But this is basically the whatever Cray gives us.
Yeah, would be very interested in that if you can find that out. Thanks.
Okay. So again, I won't spend too much time on this slide. Mike talked about it. There are three allocation programs that Mike mentioned, the Insight, which spends 60% of the yearly allocation on science allocation on. Then there is the 30% of the ALCC projects and 10% of the discretionary projects. For Theta, once it finishes acceptance and once the early science program is done, next year, it is going to be used for this program, the data science program, until the ALCC program kickstarts in middle of next year. So it's not going to be used for Insight at all. So the ADSP call for ADSP was announced, I think, in June of this year and finished in August, I think. We got some very interesting proposals. We haven't publicly announced them. I think the date is sometime in the end of the month, but we've kind of informed the folks. There'll be two tier one proposals, which means that you get a postdoc to support your project, and two tier two projects. So we are really looking forward to working with them. The massive amount of memory, the 192 gigs of memory, which is a huge luxury for us compared to our mirror nodes, the local SSDs, the commodity instruction set architecture that we were, again, not exposed to with the proprietary PowerPC in Mira, which would allow us to, you know, build machine learning and deep learning frameworks or support things like Apache Spark, makes it very conducive for data science type of projects to run on the system, and we plan to use it for those. So the announcements would come out very soon, and these picked projects will be supported for 2 years. They do have to apply for a renewal after year one, and we plan to announce this program or continue this program every year. If you have any questions, Venkat Vishwanath is the person who leads this program, so you should talk to him. So I can't, unfortunately, show you any performance results, but I didn't want to make this sound like a Cray/Intel marketing talk. So here are two things. These are two Codal scalable science applications, Neckbone and Hack, that were contributed by Argonne in the Codal partnership. And Neckbone is something that Scott Parker, who's somewhere around here, if you can wave your hands, or somewhere up there, okay, on the other side. It works on, and the Hack kernel that was tuned for our Gordon Bell, and we continue to work on it, is worked on by Vitaly Morozov, who's also on my team. So if you have any questions, they are the people who should answer them and not me. So this is basically both these two slides, this one on Neckbone and the other on Hack, were presented at ISC by the KNL chief architect. So I'm using this slide here. They were run on the JLSC machines, and we've got Intel permission to present. The JLSC machines has both the bin 1, the 7250, and the bin 3, 7210. So this is basically, the Neckbone does much of its work in matrix multiply. And it fits in IPM, and IPM is the higher bandwidth, I think something in the order of 512 gigabytes per second. So this basically shows you that the KNL outperforms the Haswell Xeon nodes. And my next slide is the Hack full application results. So this is not just the Hack kernel that that is tuned, that has been tuned and runs maybe at 50 to 60% of peak. I don't know the exact number, but this is just the full application. The first one, the 320 cube problem, fits into IPM. The 512 cube problem actually accesses DDR4, and on the average, it runs about 5x or 6x faster than the BlueJeanQ node. So we are very happy about it. So if you have any questions, you can talk to me or talk to Scott and Vitaly directly in the next 3-4 days or during the break. That's all I had. Any questions?
Yeah,
the interest of time, I'd ask you to wait a few minutes for questions, and I guess John's next? Okay. Yeah, good.
Okay. Mike? Am I on? Okay. Hi, my name is John Kaz. I work at the Texas Advanced Computing Center. I'm in charge of the HPC Applications Group. I am not a sysadmin, although there's some sysadmin components in this talk, and I'll do my best to present them. I know just enough to get into a little bit of trouble and know when I need to stop. So I'm going to talk to you today about an upgrade to Stampede. That's our current large system at TACC, which is a dual socket Sandy Bridge system with KNC cards on every node. This is an upgrade that was built into the original solicitation, and it's basically a separate KNL system. This was integrated by Dell. It was a partnership between TACC, Dell, and Intel to get this installed. We got it installed sort of late May, early June. The delivery stretched over the end of May. It's 1.5 petaflops of power. Each KNL node has 96 gigs of RAM. These are the 68 core KNL parts, 16 gigs of MCD RAM, and it's all connected with Intel's OmniPath infrastructure. Let's see, what else do you want to say? It shares a file system with Stampede, and so the idea is we're about to open it up to all of our users. Right now we're still in the early user phase, but since we share the file system with the existing Stampede system, when users get on this, they'll have their same home directory, same scratch and work directory, all of their codes will be there. Hopefully they'll just be able to recompile and probably have a little bit of help from us to get their codes up and running. So I'm moving through this pretty quickly to try to make up time. The main thing I'm going to concentrate on in a little bit are the issues we've been having. So right now, we're in early user phase, 17 projects, 73 users, a large range of codes that are running. And so far, mostly what we've done with these users is just get them on, sort of point them in the right direction, let them help them understand what the queues mean, all the different modes of the KNL, and get them to compile and run. We haven't done a lot of code modifications or analysis of their codes yet. So we're running on top of Intel 16 software stack, but we're about to move to 17 because it fixes some issues for us in Intel MPI. And yeah, just a note there that once again, Intel has changed their version numbering and we're trying to keep up. And we have users ask us all the time, well, wait, what version is this? Isn't there a newer version of Intel? And we have to tell them that there's usually a difference between the parallel stack, the MPI stack, and the compiler stack in MKL, but I think they're finally normalizing on something. These are some of the things we've done in the past 3 months. We've offered many tutorials. We have a tutorial tomorrow. We had a tutorial yesterday. We have tutorials at SC. We have tutorials at ISC. And many presentations and papers just talking about our initial experiences with KNL. We're trying to get the word out there, and we're trying to discuss our experiences with other people because it changes almost day to day, at least week to week. We've been through, I think, 3 or 4 BIOS changes and I think at least 3 kernel updates since we started doing this 3 months ago. And that leads me to what I really want to discuss here, because I want to bring this up in case other people are having it or haven't seen it yet. So the first one is, we noticed when we ran a single MPI task per nodes, our threads got pinned to a single core. You know, this was a little confusing at first because we do lots of scaling runs, benchmarking, and you'd look and it's like, well, wait, why is this one guy, why is the performance so poor? What happened? And yeah, we found out that the default settings for Intel MPI was pinning all the threads to one core. And so it was sort of easy to work around, but it was pretty annoying. This is one of the reasons we're going to upgrade to Intel 17. The problem seems to disappear there. Here's another issue that we have ongoing. We have a user with an astrophysics code running on Charm++. I think it's pretty much Charm++ and MPI. And only with his code, we don't see this with anybody else's code, we see soft core lockups. Appears to be at the end when he's writing a restart file, and it appears to be related to Lustre. So I'm really interested in your experiences with Lustre and how you see Lustre interacting with your nodes. Although I know you're on Craze and Lustre's kind of removed, right? Because you go through the LNET router and then do you have to go through the DVS to get to the node? No? Well, we'll talk after this. Because, yes, a question, a quick question?
You can't solve it. I would suggest try to run it on our benchmarking cluster Endeavor to see if you experience the same issues.
Benchmarking cluster
Endeavor.
Oh, Endeavor. Okay. And well, we are working with Intel right now to on basically all of these issues. We're in contact with Intel, and I don't know that this issue has been reproduced, but I'm about to talk about a few more issues. Before I do that, I want to explain a little bit about the memory architecture here. So I'm just talking about the MCD RAM and all the different ways you can configure MCD RAM. I'm not talking about the other clustering modes that they have for the nodes. In total, there are 25 different ways to boot a KNL node. So I'm talking about just five. So first, there's cache mode. We really like this mode because this is where we plan to send most of our users because it's invisible to them. MCD RAM hopefully just works. They don't have to worry about changing the way their codes work. And there's flat mode, in which the user gets to decide where to allocate their memory. Do I put it in the high-speed memory? Do I leave it in DDR? If I use more memory than is available in the high-speed memory, as a user or a developer, I'm going to have to decide which arrays need to go in the high-speed memory. Which arrays can I afford to leave in DDR? And us as a center who provides support to the users, we're going to have to help them. And so in our early user period, we haven't done much of this, but we're about to open this up to all of the users on the Stampede, of which there are 1,000 projects and 5,000 users. So I'm not sure how many of them are going to be interested in this, but we see it coming, which is why we really like cache mode. Then there's hybrid mode, where I can mix and match. I can choose how much of each I want to do. And to be honest, we haven't even looked at this. We haven't had time. We haven't even considered it. But John Levesque had some interesting things to say yesterday about hybrid mode and how maybe this can help us with some of our issues I'm about to talk about. OK, so cache mode, good. Users don't have to do anything. It just works, right? Okay, come on. Problem is, it's a black box. We don't know what's going on in cache mode. And so far, this is where we're seeing our issues with cache mode. So for the experienced programmers, flat mode, we expect, is going to be the best mode. This is where we're going to send the people who are developing the community codes when they really want to know how to use the MCD RAM. We're going to work with them on this. But we're really counting on cache mode for the majority of our users. The problem is we've had issues. Our first issue was nodes kept crashing. It took us a while to figure out what was going on. Oh, wait, it's only the nodes that are configured in cache mode. Wait, they would crash even when they're idle. This was really surprising. And we seem to have linked this to Lustre somehow. We're not sure. That soft lockup issue seems to be Lustre related too. This problem was fixed by turning C states off. So now we're working with Intel to test a couple of new BIOSes where hopefully we can enable C states again and mount Lustre, because they discovered when they unmounted Lustre, never occurred. Okay. We have another cache mode issue. This is one John Levesque spoke about in fairly good detail yesterday about a degradation of performance in cache mode. We noticed that performance was best right after a KNL reboot, and that over time, we see a degradation in stream performance and HPL. Now, for a lot of our applications, we really didn't notice this, but once we did, started doing an analysis. And so the next set of slides were given to me by John McAlpin, and so I sort of understand this, and at the end you can ask questions and I'll try to answer them, but most of this was done by John. And so he did a detailed analysis of the stream performance in cache mode, and what he sees after they've been up a while, that performance drops off greatly because you have all these cache misses. And the problem is, or he thinks, it has something to do with the free page list in this 16 gigabyte direct map cache. You have a question now, or can we wait until the end? Okay. So John's been working with Intel to try to figure out a way around this. And one of the things Intel has done is in, I think, the latest version of the software that's been released, there is a sorter that you can call that will resort the free pages in the MCD RAM cache. And so we've set it up so that this is called in our prolog script. So before the beginning of each job, this sorter is called to try to get back some of our performance. John's also done a little bit of work trying to see, well, what if instead of transparent huge pages, I'm using statically allocated large pages? Well, will that help? And it helps some. And so here are the results. So you can see when we use the sorter, we get some of our performance back, or at least we stop the drop, right? Once we get to about 8 gigs, it kind of levels out. But still, we've got this huge drop in performance. If we use the static large pages, now we don't get the drop till later. In other words, we hold on to our performance, but it still drops. John's working with Intel on this. They've got some ideas, I think something to do with the kernel and how it sorts the pages and how this is arranged. They're working on it. And I'm hoping we can certainly do something to improve this performance of the cache mode, because this is where we're headed. Now, this gets back to, well, maybe if we can keep performance up to 8 gigs, maybe we split the cache into 8 gigs cache, 8 gigs of flat memory, and if you can at least fit into 8 gigs, you'll get your performance. We're running CentOS 7 point something. Well, we probably got it, because that's, we're doing several tests with the kernel, with BIOS. Our lead admin is in contact with Intel, and John McAlpin's working actively with some Intel engineers to try to figure out how we can work around this. Okay, I'm running out of time. I'm gonna jump ahead and just show a couple of slides on application performance, because we've been accepted. Well, it's a Dell Intel system, but yeah, Cray's not in the mix here, although I'll have a little mention of Cray in a minute. Okay, so here are the configuration benchmarks that we looked at when we got the KNL, and the main thing I want you to notice here is we're comparing all these different modes of the KNL that you can configure it, but mainly look at the difference between using MCD RAM and not using MCD RAM. The first code is a lattice Boltzmann code. The second, MiniFE, is a finite element microkernel, and they're very memory bandwidth dependent. And you can see the strong impact of MCD RAM. this is, I'd say this is one of the three things that makes the KNL node very performant. High speed or high bandwidth memory, the vectorization, and the multiple cores, those three things. Those are the things you need to utilize to get performance out of this. And as soon as you turn off the MCD RAM performance, the comparison is huge. Notice there's one gray bar that's not very high. That's because this was running in SNC4 mode. And for the people who've looked at the KNLs in the different modes, in this mode, there are 8 NUMA nodes. So you have to be very careful how you pin processors and how you set memory affinity, because if you get it wrong, you get not the greatest performance. It's also maybe the most powerful because you have the most control over where you put your processes and how you handle your memory. WRF is a weather code that is fairly memory bandwidth dependent, and so you see the influence of MCD RAM. And the last two there are MD codes, and they show almost no dependence on memory bandwidth. Okay, I'm just going to show one more application slide. I'm not going to go, I've got more detailed results, but we don't have time for them. So here I'm just showing an analysis of the difference between Sandy Bridge. So this is on the regular Stampede system, not using KNC, dual socket Sandy Bridge nodes. Lone Star 5, which is our Cray system that has dual socket Haswell nodes in KNL. So Flash does extremely well. Gromax, we're still having an issue with, but we're working with Intel to understand it because they get much better results. And we're trying to figure out what's different in our installation of Gromax and our environment, why we're not getting as good performance as they do. And WRF does great. So for NOAA, I'm recommending KNL. Then, I can't read that one. Okay, and so NAMD, this is a new version of NAMD. I don't know if it's the public release, but it does well because we did run the original version. It did not do well at all on KNL. But the one we downloaded from the developer's distribution does pretty well. And then Quantum Espresso, and then I know someone in here is speaking about Quantum Espresso either today or tomorrow, and I'm unsure which version of Quantum Espresso this is. Now, Blast is horrible. Blast, I think, is a pure MPI code with no vectorization, no multi-threading. It's the bio code. And even though I have 68 cores versus 24, just the slower clock speed is not enough to overcome it. This is one of these applications where, like Joe said, really need to rethink how the algorithm works. Okay, so that's it for me. Do you want to do questions, or do you want to just get Richard up here, and then we'll do questions at the end? Okay.
Mic on? Hear me? Okay, good. So I want to give a brief update on NERSC. As Kumar said, we have some of the same restrictions. Our machine's just now being put together, and I'll describe that a little bit. So I don't have a lot of details to talk about, but stop and ask me questions at any time. I'm happy to answer what I can. So I'm from NERSC, so just for some people who maybe aren't familiar with NERSC, I'm going to say just a minute about what NERSC is. We are the mission computing facility for the Department of Energy Office of Science. So the Office of Science does basic science research, mostly in the physical sciences. So it's the Department of Energy, so you'll see lots of energy-related things. But whereas we do some applied research and some engineering, a lot of it is really basic science stuff. So you'll see a lot of things up there with nuclear physics and fundamental forces and all that kind of stuff too. So this is actually one of our big challenges is we don't, 80% of the time, actually 90% of the time at NERSC is given out by the Office of Science through either a base program that supports the research or through ALCC, which is 10% of the time at NERSC, as described earlier. So one of our challenges is we don't pick the people that compute at NERSC, the DOE does, and it's in our mission and in our challenge to get all comers, basically, running on whatever hardware we have. So that's a lot of our big challenge is getting, I'll describe in a minute, getting applications running on KNL, but then getting everybody eventually running on KNL and running well on a mini core system. So right now at NERSC we have two systems on the floor in production. The first one is called Edison. It's an Ivy Bridge system. You can see some of the stats there. It's a pretty big system. We have about 150, or I guess it's 130,000 cores, and our users love Edison. I mean, Edison is just everybody's favorite machine. It's a Cray system. We've had Cray systems now for a couple of generations, and one reason they love Edison is they were able to take their codes off our previous system, Hopper, which was an AMD MagniCore system, and get it running on Edison. But the codes really screamed on Edison. And the reason, I mean, there are a number, Ivy Bridge has a number of advantages, but I think the real reason is that Edison had about three times the memory bandwidth that that Hopper did. And so people, with about the same clock speed and the same number of cores per node, our users were seeing two, three, four times the performance on a core by core or node by node basis. And so it's that memory bandwidth that was really important to a lot of the codes. And that's one of the things that's really exciting about having the high bandwidth memory on Knights Landing. So we hope people can take advantage of that. Edison also has the Aries Interconnect. It's a Cray XC system. And so for us and for our users, the network on the core system, which is coming in, I'll talk more about that in a second, is the same. So it's the same network, it's the same cabinets, a lot of the things are the same. And we also have a Cori phase one. So Cori is going to have two partitions, or two, which came in two phases. The first phase was a Haswell system, and what was it, about 1,600 nodes. I think Cray, if the Cray people here can tell me, I think it's an XC40, but they changed the numbers, and I think the 40s are Haswell and above. But one thing that Cori phase one does have already that the combined system will have is a burst buffer. So there's an NVRAM burst buffer. It's not attached to each node. It's attached to the global file system on the network. And so this is one interesting piece of architecture that the Cori system has. And people have been on it, I think. Andre, you were on it a lot, right? So if you have questions about our current burst buffer performance, this is the guy to see right here. So it also has a large Cray, Synexion, I guess it's branded by Cray, Lustre file system with about 700, I don't think I have it up here, but I think it's about 700 terabytes a second of I.O. Or gigabytes a second of I.O. So Cori phase two, which is going to be the Knights Landing partition, is being installed right now as we speak. So it will have about 9,300, it will have 9,300 KNL nodes. We have the 68 core parts, and there'll also be 96 gigabytes of DRAM on each node. And of course, the 16 gigabytes of high bandwidth memory. Again, we have to support the entire science community, and this is the system that really is going to be getting our users on the road to whatever comes next and on the road to exascale. And I mentioned the stuff about the data science support on this system, so we really have a vision of really an integrated system that has data analysis and computing and simulation all on the same system. Access to the same resources, access to the same file system, to the burst buffer, and in principle, you could run a single job across both partitions at the same time, the Haswell and the Knights Landing, because we're going to have a single integrated batch scheduler, which is SLURM, which is one thing that we're having to do a lot of research on right now to get it working the way we want it. But so the system will be integrated, it'll be on the same Aries network, et cetera. So real quick, for those of you, most of you probably don't know who Gertie Cori is. She was the first American woman to receive a Nobel Prize and the first woman ever to receive a Nobel Prize in physiology and medicine. And she discovered a mechanism of how glycogen is broken down into muscle tissue and lactic acid, and then it's resynthesized. So there's a cycle that's called the Cori cycle. That's one of the famous things. And this is This is a picture of her shown in her lab with her husband, who also won a Nobel Prize. But I often think it's interesting that in this case, it's the husband's name I have to always go look up, right? So it's not the woman. So her husband Carl has also won a Nobel Prize. And so this continues the tradition of naming our systems after scientists and engineers. And I've listed our last few systems there, or last bunch of systems there. And if there's any names you don't recognize, you should go Google them, and you might learn something about somebody you didn't know. So I'll say in a minute about what the actual status is, but the system is there, the full KNL system. We powered it up. I think I have a slide again in a second, and I'll say more about it. But it arrived, and it was put together, and I've got a little video here of the system arriving, and let's see if I can make it work. Let's see. Margin is hiding my. On my screen.
Press it.
On my screen, a little thing keeps popping up every time I move the mouse over to the button. Let's try it again. There we go. Okay, so it goes pretty fast. But so the system arrived. This is real time, right? Those Cray guys are really fast. System arrived at our building in Berkeley, and now it's gone. But the truck pulled up, and it's not easy. And if you've been at Berkeley Lab, all these hairpin turns, this big truck has to go up and back up, and that was pretty impressive. So there, the Cray engineers are there assembling the system. If I could slow it down for a second. Let's see, can I even stop it? So if you watch, this actually shows the architecture of the cabinet. As you can see there, as was described earlier, there are two compute cabinets and then a fan cabinet in between, and then two more, and then a fan cabinet. So the airflow comes in one end of the column of the row and goes through, gets cooled off, and then comes out the other end at about the same room temperature. So you can see right there is one of the fan cabinets, right? And then if I start it again, you'll see them putting some of the compute cabinets back in. Oh, another thing is that we're in Berkeley. We're right on the next big one, fault line, earthquake-wise. But one thing you'll notice is that they're just putting it on the floor. In Oakland, in our old facility, each rack had to go on this earthquake platform. In Berkeley, at our new facility, the whole floor is on wheels, essentially, so it can roll if the big one hits. So now they're putting the trays in and for the network, assembling the copper. All that, you can see all the copper wires kind of in the back that do the chassis connections, and then the optical cables go up and over from column to column. So that was the arrival of Cory, and that's pretty much this data's in. It's been cleaned up a little bit, but it's sitting there right now. Okay, so the status. As of the system was brought in, it was powered up, Cray ran some stress tests and some checkouts, and everything looked good. It was all the Cory Phase 1 system came with all the service blades, the I/O blades, the login nodes, the network nodes for the whole system. And so when the Phase 2 system arrived, it didn't have any of that stuff. So some stuff was stolen from some test systems and things, and kind of a bare bones environment was made so that one or two staff people could get on and try to run a few things as a standalone system. But we only had it maybe for, two or three days. So a few people were on. They tried a few things. I guess that's on the next thing. And now the system on Monday was taken away. So the Phase 1 system is down, the Phase 2 system is down, and they've started the integration. So what's going to be going on this week, right now as we speak, is that they're taking those blades out of the Phase 1 racks that go into the Phase 2. They're putting them there. The holes that are left are going to be filled with additional Haswell blades. And then everything has to be cabled and recabled and put back together. The I/O blades have to be reconfigured. There's some cabinet reconfig that has to go on because apparently the airflow over the two different kinds of blades, the Haswell and the Knight's Landing, is different. And so we had an illegal configuration for a while with in our test system that had the two different kinds in the same rack, which is causing this problem. So there's some baffles that have to be switched and just a lot of work. So this is scheduled to take up to 6 weeks. We hope it takes less, but that's what's going on right now. A lot of storm configuration going on. And please, I meant to say this at the beginning. That graphic there is, don't give me grief. This is art. This is not a realistic depiction of how you could connect the two parts. But just admit to say that they're both going to be on the same Cray Aries network. And then we hope to get the NESAP code teams, which I'll describe in a second, on as soon as possible. So as soon as the integrated system can come back up and can support running jobs, we'll get people on. So Jack DeSlip will say more about NESAP and some of the results later, so I'm not really going to talk about any of the results we have on early hardware. But I just wanted to introduce our NESAP team for those of you who don't know. This is our kind of equivalent of your early science program and that sort of thing. But we have identified about 20 applications that we've been working with for about 2 years now, really in depth, to try to get their codes ready for Cory. And you can see there's lots of things that the teams get. A lot of close interactions with the vendors and developer workshops, including we've really had a lot of successful collaborations with both Cray and Intel helping these code teams, including some what we call dungeon sessions. They take the teams up to Portland and really work with Cray and Intel intensely over a few days, and I think that's been really useful and productive. And then the leveraging the community efforts has really been a huge part of this. So this is part of the whole community efforts, and I think that our team is big for our standards, but we're just still one center and have a limited number of resources. And being able to tap into a community like this has really been invaluable for the team. The next slide is interesting because as of this morning at about 8 o'clock, this was a pie a circular pie chart. And so I would even have no idea how to make this happen in PowerPoint whatsoever. But nonetheless, it seems to have happened. What it's supposed to show is that, the slide really got messed up. What it's supposed to show is that we looked at the workload where we picked these codes. Remember, we have about 6,000 users and then something on the order of a little bit less than 1,000 different codes to run. But we looked at the workload and found that about 10 codes made about 50% of the hours used, and 20 codes made up about two-thirds, or 25 made up two-thirds. So we picked the NESAP teams to either be those codes or codes that were similar or represented an algorithm that was similar, and then we've been working with them, and then what we want to do is take those lessons learned and apply them to the whole community. So this is part of that, and training and that sort of thing is part of that. So as I said, a few people were on the phase two system very briefly before it was down. We tried to run a few things. Some things worked, some things didn't work for various reasons, but we really didn't have any time to figure out why they didn't work or why they did work. So we were just trying to get some things to run. So the NESAP team will get access as soon as possible. We're hoping we can get people on to actually do something and digest it a little bit before supercomputing, but I guess we'll just see. The work continues. We have a test system, and people will be testing and running on that. And if you want to know some of the details, we do actually have lots and lots of good performance results on early hardware, on some white boxes we had, and on our test and development system we have. And so come to Jack's talk this afternoon. He'll talk a lot about that. Just want to point out that this is really a big effort for us. We're not a huge center. We have a staff of about 60, and about half of those are kind of sysadmin types, and the other half are on the other side. And so this has really pretty much been an all-hands-on-deck effort for NERSC. These are the staff members that have been involved. And then we have six, and we soon hope to have eight postdocs that are working with some of these 20 teams. And a lot of them are here. I think Jack will introduce them later. But they've done fantastic jobs. So the postdoc program and embedding the postdocs with the science teams has been a huge payoff for everybody, and they're really just doing a wonderful job. But my main message right now is that we're just we're just waiting until that system comes back, and we can't wait to get on and kind of get our hands on and get some experiences. It's been 2 years we've just been waiting for this to happen, and we're just waiting for it to come up and get the codes on there and see how they do. So that's all I had. I'll take any questions.
Okay, so we have kind of 10, 15 minutes here to ask kind of cross site questions or things and see how the answers compare. So questions?
You limit on number of questions he can ask, right?
I'm sorry, I tried to make use of my time here. How do you plan to work with the different KNL modes, memory mode, and cluster mode, and maybe also the one of the other different kernel options that users want to have for specific codes?
So I guess I'll take a stab at it first, and Jack can say more too. Is we're experimenting to see what seems to work best. We do want to find a reasonable default, which we haven't arrived at an answer yet, even on the early hardware, because as was mentioned yesterday, right now it does take, if you have to reboot to get to a different mode, it takes quite a while to get, that reboot is still taking quite a while. So it's not something that we want to do regularly, but the answer is that we're just experimenting to see what seems to work best for most codes or how much difference it actually makes on individual codes. And I don't really have a good answer because we just don't have that much experience yet.
I'll just add a few things to that. So one thing is rebooting takes a long time, but today you have to power cycle the nodes when you have to change the memory modes. Intel is working on a BIOS fix where you don't have to do a complete power cycle. This is not an urgency for us because in the next few months, we'll be just supporting the early science projects, which we can count fingers on your hand, and also the ADSP program. But when it is used as a production resource, our goal or hope is, all this has not been solved completely, but is to have different partitions supporting different modes, and so you would have different queues in your scheduler so that people can submit jobs, and we will vary that depending upon how people are running and which mode seems to be more popular than the other. So
that's interesting. That's something we've talked about but haven't decided if that's where we want to go or not.
That's exactly what we've done. We've got queues for most of the different modes. Our default queue is normal, which is going to be cache quadrant. Our next largest queue is going to be flat quadrant. And then we got SNC4 flat, and I think all-to-all flat. And the two largest queues are the quadrant modes. And again, we'll change as the users start running. And if they request to run, oh, I want to run on 100 nodes in this mode, we'll have to reconfigure. But we can reboot in about 3 minutes. So.
I had the same problems on Endeavor. Unfortunately, I don't have so many nodes there that I can do the queue or the partitioning-based approach. So I had to put in a solution that allows to reboot. But I'll talk tomorrow about that at 8:45. So
okay.
You're cool. Interested.
We have discussed basically rebooting on demand and having some sort of slurm script, right, that will reconfigure the node. But we haven't tried to implement it yet because we're still in early user mode too, and we're not sure what the demand will be. But if you've already got something, that would be great. Anybody?
When you ask questions, remember that you're keeping people away from lunch today. So.
Yeah. So I just have one question. So. Cori and Stampede are going to have both KNL nodes and Xeon CPU nodes in the one system. So is there any suggestions or comments about applications that trying to use those two nodes at the same time? So is there any?
So in our current Stampede upgrade, you will not be able to run on both at once. We have a follow-on to Stampede coming that will have KNL and something else. And on that system, maybe. But on our current system, they don't share a network, right? So the new system is Omnipath. The old system is InfiniBand QDR. And so we share file systems, but we don't share a network, and the SLURM scheduler is separate. So we have no plans on the current system to let you run on both.
So on Cori, you could, assuming we get SLURM to allow it. And so I'll be fascinated to see who wants to use it and what they could do. I mean, you could imagine, for instance, doing a simulation, a cosmology simulation or something, on the KNL partition, and then wanting to fire off some kind of real-time visualization on intermediate results or something like that. So I know it's something we want to give people the ability to do, and just let them see what kind of creative things they can come up with.
So I have one actually about scheduling. What are your plans? I know some are using SLURM. We have COBOL. But how is that going, or what are the plans?
Our plans, we will be using SLURM. It's going. That's one of the things we're trying to figure out. So SLURM, we're using what's called native SLURM. So it's not only SLURM for trying to schedule the resources and you know figure out where you're going to run when, but it's also the SLURM job launcher. So there's a lot of things we're trying to figure out how that works.
So you will be using SRun to launch jobs.
We're using SRun to run jobs.
That's how we run our query. We're not using AP run.
So beyond that, we're first trying to get it so that people can run independently on the two different halves with SLURM, with one scheduler that does both, and then we'll figure out what we want to do. But we're kind of in the early stages.
Cobalt is our native scheduler. We develop it. We have a development person. He's sitting in the last row. If I speak for Cobalt, he'll shoot me down. So if you guys have questions, you can. He's the tallest guy in HPC. You can meet him and talk to him about it. So, oh yeah, you didn't. I knew. So.
We're just using SLURM. That's what we use on all our systems now. So that's what we have implemented.
Questions? Is it one of the? Okay. No, just stretching. All right, good.
It doesn't count.
All right, so let's thank all three of our speakers. Yeah.